Hi. I will tell you in this lecture how we can search for dark matter particles with a Fermi LHC satellite. As you have probably heard in these lectures, dark matter exists. Scientists believe that there is solid evidence that, that there is such thing as dark matter in the universe, and evidence for dark matter, which is some new particle, some new mass that exists in the universe, comes from a variety of scales. For example, if you look at this plot, every dot is a galaxy here. And from this way the galaxies cluster in the universe, we can sort of, by modeling the way this happened, we can actually convince ourselves that there is such thing as dark matter. Same thing happens at the scales of clusters of galaxies, which are groups of hundreds of galaxies. Also, the way galaxies move in clusters of galaxies can convince us that dark matter exists. Similar is at the scale of galaxies, like only one galaxy, the way stars move within a galaxy, or in the tiniest galaxies in the universe. So from all these variety of scales, scientists always find the evidence that dark matter exists. But one thing to note is that all evidence we have is gravitational. So we basically know that there are some particles, some mass, that interacts gravitationally with matter. But we do not have any other sign from these particles, what they could be. So what we are trying to find in modern science, now in dark matter search, is what is that particle? How does it couple with other particles that we know? How abundant it is? Actually, why it is abundant as we know that it is today. For example, we today know that the amount of dark matter in the universe is just few times the amount of all the normal matter in the universe. So why these amounts are so similar? Is it composite or elementary? Do we have many dark matter different particles or just one kind, and so on? So these are all the questions that scientists are trying to answer in these times. And so, wondering what it could be, this particle, basically scientists proposed various possibilities. Putting the mass of particles between 10 to the 40 kilograms to 10 to the minus 30 electron volts. So basically, there are many, many possibilities. And we still do not know which one it is. But one of the most popular masses that we look dark matter at is around hundreds of GeV. So why is that? Such models are actually called weakly interacting massive particles, or WIMPs. And so why do we think that particle around 100 GeV, which is 100 times heavier than proton, could be dark matter? It is because we know that the standard model, the model of particle physics that we have today, is incomplete. And many theories believe that some new particles in mass close to the gauge bosons, to Z and W bosons, could complete our standard model. Also, another thing that we that people notice is that if particle would have mass around 100 GeV, it would interact with such a cross-section that in the universe, if such particles interacted with each other early on and then stopped interacting and just remained in the universe, one could explain the observed amount of dark matter that we know for a fact today. So basically, we know how much dark matter there is, and by reverse engineering, we can understand that if the particle would have 100 GeV, then this model would be very simple and natural to explain its origin. And this is why these WIMP, so-called WIMP models, are the most popular in dark matter search. Another reason why they're so popular is because they're predictive. In a sense, as I was saying before, if we postulate that dark matter particle has around 100 GeV, then we more or less know the interaction size, cross-section, with which it should interact with each other, if it is to explain the amount of dark matter we observe today. And so basically, then we know where to look. We know which cross-sections it should have. So what is the idea then of search for such particles? The main idea is that we postulate that in the early universe, two dark matter particles interacted with each other and by annihilation to standard model particles. Okay, and then at some point, this sort of interaction ceased to happen. They did not annihilate anymore, and they remain stable in our universe. This is this dark matter. However, they do not annihilate anymore because universe is much less dense, But if you look at the centers of galaxies or in some places where there is lots of dark matter, then this interaction could still happen. Two dark matter particles could still annihilate, produce usual particles, which would then necessarily decay to photons, neutrinos, electrons, protons, and so on. And the idea is to look for excess of these astrophysical messengers in astrophysical objects where we know there is a lot of dark matter. And so we actually now live in the golden age for such a strategy, because in the past 10 or 20 years, many sensitive experiments in this 100 GeV mass range, energy range, became available and are taking data now. So if one thinks that, if the two dark matter particles annihilate to photons, we now have several experiments, such as ground-based Cherenkov telescopes, like CASS, MAGIC, and so on, satellites, such as Fermilab or Agile, or water Cherenkov, such as the Hawke Observatory, to look for those extra gamma rays and to try to find dark matter. Similar situation is with neutrinos. If two dark matter particles annihilate producing neutrinos, we now have Ice Cube and Antares experiments that actually do look for this signature. Similar story for charged particles. We have AMS, PAMELA, that could look for extra electrons or protons in the cosmic ray data. So what I will focus now is in this search for in gamma rays. So gamma rays, as you know, cannot cross the atmosphere. When they arrive to the atmosphere, they produce particle showers. And so there are two strategies to look for gamma rays. One is to go above the atmosphere to look for them in satellites, and one is to look on the ground. I will focus on this satellite experiment, which is called Fermilab. So Fermilab is now 10 years old this year. It was launched in 2008. And all its data is public. So not only experimentalists who work on the experiment, but everybody could analyze its data. So how does it work? How do you detect a neutral photon? So how it works is that photons arriving to the telescope pass through tracking to silicon tracker. And before silicon tracker, you have conversion foils. So basically, photon converts to electron and positron, and then electron and positron path is tracked in this silicon tracker. So basically, neutral particle is then detected by producing charged particles, and then those charged particles can be easily followed. And then they deposit all their energy in calorimeter, so we can know the direction from directions of electron and positron and the energy from all the deposited energy in the calorimeter. One important thing to notice is that there is much more protons and electrons than photons in the cosmic rays. So basically, you have 3-4 orders of magnitude more hits on the telescope than actual photons. And how that works is that then we put anti-coincidence detector around the detector so that every time charged particle passes, it blocks it. It tags it as a charged particle, and we do not care about it. So that's how we managed to reduce the backgrounds by a lot to actually be able to detect these rare photons. And so why Fermilab is so relevant for dark matter search? It is because it covers exactly this energy range from 20 MeV to above 300 GeV, which is exactly the energy where we said we expect these WIMPs to appear. Another property of these telescopes is that it has large field of view. So basically, it scans 20% of the sky at every instant and crosses all the sky every 3 hours. So basically, in this way, we actually can look everywhere on the sky and exactly in the energy range where we believe these WIMP particles exist. Basically, this is the sky that Fermi measures. So what you can see, first thing, is this very, very bright plane. So this is actually the plane of the Milky Way, of our own galaxy. Okay, and you see that it shines very brightly in gamma rays. And why is that? It is because there is many, many charged cosmic rays in the galaxy that interact with gas and light in the galaxy and produce photons through secondary emission, through energy losses. So this is one thing that Fermi sees and studies in detail. So one thing that Fermi sees very clearly, therefore, is the galactic plane, and this is something that scientists study in detail, and it made a huge contribution to science. Another thing that Fermi discovered, if one basically removes this very bright emission, are so-called Fermi bubbles. So if you, maybe you can see it around here, but once when you remove the plane, you basically see these huge, huge structures that come from the galactic center. They're called Fermi bubbles. They're a big surprise in science, actually. Nobody expected them to be there. Moving on from this extended emission to point sources, Fermi detected many, many gamma ray sources, 3,000 in 3-year catalog, and now we have thousands more. This is a huge, huge contribution to science because before Fermi, only hundreds of sources were known. So again, it detected many, many sources, and scientists are studying them in detail. And the third thing is isotropic emission. So basically, from outside of galaxy, photons are coming to us from extragalactic objects, making this background isotropic emission that one can also study and learn a lot about astrophysics and dark matter as well. So now focusing on dark matter signal, what it is, how we think we can find it in this data. So this is, here you see the flux of gamma rays that would come from dark matter and what they would depend on. They would depend, let's focus first here, they would depend on how much dark matter you have along your line of sight. So basically, more dark matter you have, higher the signal, that is clear. And because you need two dark matter particles to annihilate, you have the density of dark matter squared and contributes to this integral of the amount of dark matter, because two are necessary for annihilation. So first parameter, it comes from cosmology, is if you look around in some target, like how much dark matter you have along the line of sight. Another thing is particle physics. So what is the cross-section of dark matter? How often, how likely it is that two dark matter particles will actually find each other and annihilate? And what is the actual spectrum, energy spectrum, that each signal annihilation produces? So let me tell you a little bit more about this. So for example, if one thinks about the spectrum, so what is the energy distribution of photons as a product of two dark matter particles annihilating? So what happens? Two dark matter particles annihilate. We do not know physics here. This is what we want to learn. But independently on that, we hope that it will produce some of the standard model particles, like gauge bosons, quarks, leptons. Gauge bosons and quarks will produce jets, which would then produce pions, and pions will annihilate to photons. So all this is new physics that we do not know. But all what happens here, that once if you have produced a gauge boson, how the energy spectrum of photons is very easy. It's a standard model. It is what we know to model, how to model. And we can calculate it quite easily. So this is the spectrum, number of photons in a given energy beam versus energy for different annihilation channels. And you see that if particle annihilates to quarks or gauge bosons, the spectrum is more or less smooth and more or less similar for every channel. So basically what we look is something like is this spectrum. In particular particle physics models, one could have gamma ray lines or some very hard spectra that I will not talk about here. Now, if you focus on how much dark matter we have along a line of sight, how do we know that? We do not see dark matter. That is why it's called dark. We know that dark matter density is the highest in the center of the galaxy and then drops off as a broken power law. So basically, if you want to look for dark matter, one of the brightest points is the center of our galaxy. So here I just wanted to point that search for dark matter is genuinely a multidisciplinary field. You have to use particle physics and cosmology and astrophysics as well to do this search. So what are the strategies to look for dark matter? There are several targets. So the question is, where do we look? And the targets, astrophysical objects, where we can look for dark matter can be plotted in this plane, where is how high is the expected signal of dark matter as a function of how robust the detection would be, in a sense, how messy astrophysics is in that target, because that will also make it harder for us to detect dark matter if there is lots of astrophysics. So one, the source here is the galactic center, the center of our galaxy. So in the center of our galaxy, you have the highest density of dark matter, so the signal should be the highest. However, there is lots of astrophysics in our galactic center that we do not know how to model, so any detection of dark matter would not be too robust. Any claim of detection would not be too robust and would have to be confirmed elsewhere. On the other end of things are so-called dwarf spheroidal galaxies. So these are satellite galaxies of our Milky Way, and they're tiny, tiny, so they do not have lots of astrophysics. And therefore, the signal, dark matter signal from them would be very robust. There is no gamma rays expected from there except from dark matter, but the signal, expected signal strength is lower. So it's a trade-off. So basically what people do is to either focus on this high signal, low robustness targets, but for that we have to know astrophysics very well and to model it very well, or to focus in targets where you have zero backgrounds, but expected signals are low, so you have to do fancy things in statistical analysis. So here I will focus on these two targets, therefore, on the search in the galactic center and the search of dwarf galaxies as two ends of these strategies. So if you look at the galactic center in gamma rays, as you see, it is a very messy region. You have complicated diffuse emission there. You have lots of point sources. And you have also Fermi bubbles, which I mentioned, that also contribute in that region. So basically, if you want to model this region, you have to know how to model each three of these. And that can be done. I will not go in detail, and many people have done it and noticed that basically there is such thing as galactic center excess, some weird excess that might also come from dark matter. And in fact, the properties of this excess are very intriguing because the energy spectrum of this emission, this residual emission, is something like this, which is very similar to what I told you we expect from dark matter. And the distribution, spatial distribution of the signal falls off with a distance, so it's extended and pretty much similarly to what you would expect from dark matter. If you put it on this figure where you have mass of dark matter and cross-section, you basically see that it's perfect. It's really how we expected to find it. It has around 100 GeV, and it has cross-section that is more or less what you expect from WIMPs, as I said at the beginning. So this was very exciting. However, one always, in these targets, as I was saying, they're not very robust. You expect lots of astrophysics, and it turns out that there is astrophysical sources called pulsars that have very, very similar spectrum. And in fact, Fermi, LAT satellite, found this is a number of pulsars as a function of days from the Fermi mission, and it detected in the first few years 50, and now it's almost 200-300 pulsars that we have. So it is, in fact, quite likely that these are indeed pulsars. But in dark matter search, if you have some hint of a signal in one target, we always have to confirm it, to look in different target, and if you confirm it there, we could be convinced that it is indeed due to dark matter. So the strategy here was to look in these dwarf spheroidal galaxies that I mentioned before. So around the Milky Way, there are many dwarf spheroidal galaxies, which I said have no astrophysics, and are relatively close. They're 25 to 250 kiloparsecs from Earth. So in each single target, there is not much dark matter. But because we have many, and Fermi measures all sky, so we have data from many galaxies, basically one could do very good analysis, which is to combine information we have from 15 dwarf galaxies, and to look for signal of dark matter. People have looked for that. They didn't find any signal from dark matter, and they sent constraints. So these would be constraints from dwarf spheroidal galaxies. Here is mass, and here is a cross-section. And so you see, here where we thought that the signal from galactic center is, dark matter would be exactly here, but if you look in dwarfs and we do not see them then we sort of constrain those models. So there is also exciting development, because you see, I said that this last Fermi analysis used only 15 dwarf galaxies, but now we know much more. Dark Energy Survey experiment detected more dwarf spheroidal galaxies, and LSST, which will come online in 2021, will detect many, many more of them. I just wanted to stress that that LAT looks at many targets. I told you now about galactic center of dwarfs, but LAT looks in so-called unassociated sources, in this isotropic emission that comes from extragalactic, from outside of our galaxy that I mentioned. And so these are the limits on cross-section as a function of mass for different targets. So basically, for now, we have only limits, but given that we have so many targets, if signal is found, we will be able to cross-check it in different ways. Here is another piece of information. So this would be the limits from Fermi-LAT after LSST, but at higher masses of 100 GeV up to TeV to 10 TeV, we cannot probe it with Fermi. However, the good news is that there will be a new telescope called CTA, Cherenkov Telescope Array, which will also be able to probe these swim particles at heavy masses. So in 10 years or so, we will be able to explore this cross-section that we believe for WIMPs over all masses that we believed. This is also that we do not look only with astrophysics, in astrophysics for dark matter signal. We also look in colliders and in direct detection experiments, which will probably be covered in these lectures. And so once when we combine all these three approaches, basically WIMPs are quite cornered. We are now exactly in this, as I said, golden time, and we can probe many, many of these models. They're not excluded yet, but we are improving our sensitivity. And so this is my last slide that I just wanted to mention the future prospects. Here you see, here is 2018 and 2025, and you see that in 10 years from now or so, we will have several experiments very relevant for dark matter that will come online. Plus, we have now multi-messenger astronomy with gravitational waves and neutrinos. So I just gave you a little peek on how this dark matter search looks like, but it is very rich and it will just become richer in the future. Thank you.